Thank you for joining us this evening. My name is Jennifer New. I'm the Associate Director of the Obermann Center for Advanced Studies at the University of Iowa. And this is part of our Obermann Conversation series. Tonight is actually what we allude to as a pop-up conversation. We do these every once in a while when there's something going on in the world that we feel would be that we would all understand better with the help of some of our friends on campus and related academics. So that's what we're doing this evening. We do have another Obermann Conversation coming up on March 3rd. And Jason, if you have that, you can go ahead and put it up. So this is regarding the mural on the Burlington Street parking garage, the Oracles of Iowa City. And the conversation is Igniting Change, One Wall at a Time. We're going to look particularly at this mural, but more generally at activist public art and the question of who is the public in public art, and some of the artists and other planners and researchers involved with this project, and some other public artists will all be participating in that. So join us in just, I think, 2 weeks for that event. And then Jason Polias and the Iowa City Public Library are our co-sponsors on this series, and Jason has a few announcements as well.
Thanks so much, and thanks everyone for joining, and to the Obermann and to all our panelists today. Just a quick update to say, due to the topics tonight, I think that our panelists here are going to share some great information. And just so everyone who wants to go away and keep researching on their own or just stay up to stay current on all this, to share with you that with your resident card in Iowa City Public Library card, you're eligible to get free subscription to the New York Times online, to the Washington Post online, and to the Wall Street Journal online. So you'll just need your resident card and password. You're going to go to icpl.org/nytimes or icpl.org/wapo or icpl.org/wsj. And you'll just type in your library card and password, and those will give you a 3-day or 7-day for the Washington Post subscription so that you can get behind that paywall, because I know we're all sort of maxed out on our free articles per month. So just a tip there from your library, we've got those covered for you. If you need help, there's a chat on our homepage and we'll get you set up through chat. So thanks to everyone.
Great.
And we're ready.
All right, thank you. So first of all, a big thanks to these three panelists tonight who stepped in very last moment. And I'm going to introduce them in the order in which they are speaking. So first, we'll be hearing from Daria Kuznetsova, who is a second year graduate student in the PhD program in political science at the University of Iowa. Her research interests include democratic transitions and the survival of democracies. She holds a Master's of Community and Regional Planning degree from Iowa State University, and also a Master's in Architecture from Kharkiv National University in Ukraine. Danielle Lussier is Associate Professor and Department Chair of Political Science at Grinnell. She is also Department Chair of Russian, Central European, and Eurasian Studies there. Her recent publications include the books Constraining Elites in Russia and Indonesia, Political Participation and Regime Survival, which was published in 2016 by Cambridge University Press, and also The Many Faces of Political Islam, which she co-authored with Mohammed Ayoub and was published by University of Michigan Press in 2020. And then finally, we will hear from William Reisinger, who is professor of political science at the University of Iowa, where he teaches courses on the democratization, authoritarian politics, and the politics of post-communist countries. Sorry, that's a mouthful. His research concerns politics in the former communist states, especially Russia. Among his many publications includes Russia's Regions and Comparative Subnational Politics, published by Routledge in 2012. And he is currently writing a book about how corruption in a society affects the public support for its political leaders and institutions, which he worked on as an Obermann Fellow in Residence. We were just reminiscing how that was the spring of 2020 and remembering that quick removal that we all made from campus during that spring. So again, thank you so much for being here. So Dasha, we're going to start with you, and thank you so much for sharing your insights.
Yeah, thank you, Jennifer. Jason, if you would share the slides. So I had a little bit of thought before this talk of what would be the best way to share the Ukrainian perspective on all of this crisis. And pretty much what I came up with is that we need to look back a little bit into the history of Ukraine, back at least to 2014, when the Crimea was annexed and we started having these separatist movements on the eastern side of Ukraine, and when the war in Donbas started. So I would like to share the current crisis within this a little bit of a historic perspective, and this is where I would go today with my short presentation. So the slide that you can see on your screen is from the New York Times. They shared the map of the Russian military positions as of Sunday, so that was the February 13th, the last Sunday. As you can see on the map, currently there are Russian military positions in Crimea. There's Russian military, a pretty big buildup in the occupied territories in eastern Ukraine, so the big red circle. And we also see the military being all over the Ukraine-Russia border, and also some of the troops in Belarus. So this is the current situation. Yesterday, we started getting media news about the potential beginning of de-escalation of the situation. However, as the Ukrainian government reiterated several times since then, is that we would call this de-escalation when we see the Russian troops moving back into the territory of Russia and away from the Ukrainian border. Next slide, please. So a little bit of a background. I thought it would be nice to have a comparison of how big Ukraine is. Ukraine is the biggest country in Europe, and it's pretty big. So as you can see, it spans from New York to Chicago and from Toronto to Raleigh, compared to the size of the United States. And it is relatively comparable to the size of Texas, the state of Texas in the United States. So hopefully that gives you a little bit of a perspective on the size of the country. Next slide, please. So putting this current crisis into the perspective, I would like to, as I said, go back a little bit in history and talk a little bit about the Euromaidan, the revolution of dignity, the occupation, the annexation of the Autonomous Republic of Crimea, and the war in Donbas, which is the current crisis, the current conflict that we see in Eastern Europe. Next slide, please. So a little bit of a background. So you see the map of Ukraine on the right, surrounded by all the countries that we border. Crimea is the peninsula on the east, on the south side of Ukraine. It's been annexed by Russia since 2014. On the eastern side of Ukraine, so kind of highlighted in like brownish color, is the controlled by the separatist area. You would see in the news and the media that it's usually like it might refer to occupied regions of Donetsk and Lugansk regions, or the occupied regions in Donbas. And on the left, there is a little reference, and then Donbass is the just the general name of this region, which includes both the Donetsk and Luhansk oblasts together. So a little bit of a background on the term. So they're both regions, the Donetsk and Luhansk regions, partially are occupied as of today as well. Next slide. So going back to the Euromaidan, which I think is a good starting point for describing why this current crisis is happening. So Euromaidan was a wave of demonstrations and civil unrests in Ukraine that started on 21st of November of 2013 and was inspired by at that time, Ukrainian government's decision to move away from the signing of the association agreement between the European Union and Ukraine that was, was being planned to be signed soon, and instead moving towards having closer ties with Russia and with the Eurasian Economic Union, which Russia is the current member of, and most of the post-Soviet states as well. So the Euromaidan protests ended with the what is currently known as the Revolution of Dignity. So that's a series of events that happened in February of 2014 that involved the protesters, the riot police, unknown shooters that were shooting people from the roofs of the building. And you see the photo of the Maidan Square here. This is the main square in Kiev, in the capital of Ukraine, where all of these protests took place. As the outcome of the Revolution of Dignity, so more than 100 people were shot and killed at the square. And after all the shooting and riots and repressions that Ukrainians in the square were under, the government was overthrown. And soon after that, the interim government was announced, and later the elections were held in later in 2014. Next slide, please. So while the state was under, you know, these difficult times, all of these protests, and you know, with the overthrowing of the government, it was a situation of destabilization in the country. Russia took advantage of that situation and very quickly annexed the Crimean Peninsula in March of 2014. So at the end of February of 2014, the little green man, in quotes, as they were called at the time, which as it turns out were the special forces of Russian Federation without any insignia. So nobody really knew who these people are. So they occupied and took hold of the government buildings in Crimea, specifically in Simferopol. By the overthrown president of Ukraine, President Yanukovych, at the moment asked Putin to help militarily, in terms of military, and send the military forces on his side to establish legitimacy, peace, law and order, stability, and defend the people of Ukraine. So Putin sent the military troops to, as it was the Russian message, to protect the ethnic Russians and their ability to speak Russian language in Crimea. So by the beginning of March, the peninsula was pretty much under control of the Russian forces. On March 16th, there was a referendum held in Crimea where the question asked whether people would like to join Russia, or they would restore the 1992 constitution within Ukraine, which was voided at the moment. So there was no really a status quo question in that referendum. So according to the official results that were announced, that 95% of people were in favor of joining Russia, which are the results that Ukraine considers to be rigged, and by some accounts, people think that that was somewhere between 15 and 30% of people agreeing to join Russia and not 95. Next slide, please. and we can, yeah, can keep going. Thank you. So at the same time, while, you know, there are demonstrations in Kiev, the Crimea is being annexed, at the same time, we see the beginning of the separatist movements in the eastern side of Ukraine. So you can see the Donbas region here on the map. The separatist movement started around beginning of March, so March, April, with a lot of local population being not happy with the new interim government of Ukraine. The Russian propaganda machine was working pretty actively spreading the propaganda, including there was a lot of news about the shale gas extractions in the regions that would, you know, if Ukraine joins the, signs the agreement with the European Union, Western companies would come and start extracting gas, and that would lead to very severe consequences environmentally, and like would turn the whole area into a desert. So scare tactics, stuff like that. There were Russian citizens that were organizing these separatist movements and protests, and a lot of local population at the moment supported either Donbas becoming an autonomous part of Ukraine or joining Russia. The movement escalated in May of 2014, where we began to see people with guns on the streets, some like local block posts, a movement within the territory began to be very restricted. Eventually, Russia just sent the military troops into the occupied areas. And as you can see, by May 20th of 2014, most of the territory of Donbas was under the separatist forces. By July 15th, the Ukrainian military, the Ukraine launched the anti-terrorist operation, ATO for short. So you can see the ATO progress here. So by July 15th, Ukrainian military was able to shrink the separatist controlled territory and take a lot of these territories back under the governmental control. This red, big red dot on both maps, this is my hometown where I am from. So as you can see, it was occupied for around like 2 months. My family still resides there, and I've been in a constant communication with them. So if anybody has questions on the current situation, I'm happy to answer those later. Next slide, please. So this is one of the recent maps that I was able to find. So this is as of July of 2020, the pinkish area, as you can see, this is the current occupied territory on the eastern Ukraine. The border didn't really change since 2020, so this is pretty much the current situation. And this is the reality that Ukraine has been living in since 2014, so for 8 years by now. And next slide, as we can see here, so this is from the website, this is a screenshot from the website of Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, which has a special monitoring mission to Ukraine currently. And as you can see, this is a report from yesterday, February 15th. And the mission recorded 17 ceasefire violations in the Donetsk region and 157 in Lugansk region. And this is pretty much the daily reality of people in Ukraine, specifically people in the eastern part of Ukraine. By now, approximately, it is estimated that 14,000 people were killed during the conflict since 2014. Around 3,000 of them are civilians. In addition, around 24,000 people were injured during this conflict, in addition to more than a million people being displaced from these occupied regions of Ukraine. Next slide, please. And so I would like to end my short introduction to this saying that a lot of media have been portraying Ukrainian government as downplaying the risks of this military conflict. And I guess a lot of people were surprised that Ukrainians remained relatively calm under the current situation. And the reason I think that that is what is happening is because this is not a new crisis for us. This didn't just happen a month ago. Ukraine has been in this situation for over 8 years, and the government has been addressing these problems. The government is preparing for any scenario unfolding, including the full-blown invasion. But for a lot of people, this is not a new situation. And I would like to share a short video of some interviews of Kyiv, of people from Kyiv, and how they see the current situation.
Тут якась паніка. Враховуючи, що я з Донецька, з одного боку думати про це не хочеться, але з іншого, в мене є досвід. Я сподіваюся, що все буде добре.
Небезпека є, є. Ви нервуєтесь? Ні. А чому? А це допоможе?
Okay, thank you. So as you can see, basically, the current moods is that this is not new for us. We've been in the situation before. We know how to react. Everybody is hoping for the best. There is no panic. I talked to my family and friends. There's nobody runs and buys the toilet paper. Everything is in the stores. The food is in the stores. There is no panic. There was a little bit of a lot of people were trying to withdraw cash from the banks, from ATMs, which is, I would like to mention that a lot of people, even though they receive like their salary on a credit card, they like to withdraw cash just on a regular basis. Yesterday, there was another cyber attack on Ukraine, including on two major banks. So that created a little bit of a unstable situation, but overall, the country is calm, everything is functioning, there is no panic. And that last slide that I had also had a results from the recent survey, phone survey conducted in Ukraine that says that more than 57% of Ukrainians are ready to resist an event of Russian invasion. 37 of them are ready to put the armed resistance, and 25 are ready to participate and resist in civil actions, such as demonstrations, protests, and so on. So the population is prepared to any kind of situation unfolding and just hoping for the best. Thank you, I'll stop here.
So I guess I'll just get started. And I'm gonna add to the really great points that Dasha started us off with by bringing a little bit of the Russian domestic political context into the conversation. And so what does Russia's domestic politics have to do with this current crisis? And my short answer to that is that a politically unstable Ukraine has tended to benefit Russian President Vladimir Putin's approval rating by allowing him to deflect attention away from a stagnant economy and challenges to authoritarian rule. And so what I'm going to encourage us to think about is that when we examine Russia's motivations with regard to Ukraine, we might want to remember the role that Russia's domestic politics play in this. And I'll add to this point that Russia's not a democracy. It's an electoral authoritarian regime. So while it has elections, it lacks the necessary civil liberties to ensure that the electoral arena remains open to fair and free competition. In this context, Russia's President Vladimir Putin relies on high approval ratings to legitimate his political rule. So the slide that you see in front of you is Putin's approval rating going back to when he first became acting prime minister in August of 1999. So it's covering a 20-year period. This is data that's collected by the Levada Center in Moscow, which is Russia's leading polling organization. And that black line is the approval rating and the blue line is the disapproval rating. And you'll notice that over 20 years, Vladimir Putin has had an extraordinarily high level of approval rating. It very, very rarely dips below 60%. And in the first decade of Putin's political rule, those high approval ratings were largely believed to be tied to Russia's economic growth and widespread increase in standards of living across the board, as well as a general improvement in the functioning of the public sector, particularly in comparison to what Russians experienced in the 1990s. Now, these earlier gains for maintaining high approval ratings started to flatten and decline after Putin's second term, which ended in 2008. And if you look at that, at the slide, you'll see a real drop in the period between 2012 and 2014. That's the blue circle that I've got there on that black line. And as Dasha just explained to us, in 2014, Russia annexed Crimea. And this move was met with actually quite a bit of considerable support among the Russian public. And we see this dramatic jump in the approval rating immediately after the annexation. Now, an argument that scholars make here is that an assertive foreign policy, particularly regarding territories that are part of what Russia considers to be its historical sphere of influence, is part of a broader aim within Russia to construct a national identity that emphasizes Russian great power status. So, in short, annexing Crimea helped increase Putin's domestic political legitimacy, both with the population as a whole and with a number of political elites who might have different perspectives on a range of other domestic policy issues. So it helped to deflect attention from within tensions that might exist within elite camps. So advance to the next slide, please. So here I just have a map that's a little bit redundant of some of the things that Dasha just showed us, but just to emphasize again, that bottom territory, Crimea, is the territory that was annexed by Russia and is under de facto Russian control since 2014. Although the international community does not recognize it as Russian territory, recognizes it as Ukrainian territory. And then those separatist territories on the right-hand side of the map, that those are the areas of concern right now. Next slide, please. So let's take a look at Russian public opinion on this separatist conflict. So what I have here are some public opinion data that were gathered in May of 21, also by the Levada Center. So if you look in the upper left-hand side of the slide, it asks the question, in your opinion, who's the initiator of the aggravation of the situation in Eastern Ukraine? And just note that nearly 50% of respondents, Russian respondents, say that the US or NATO are the initiators, while only 4% say that it's Russia. The other two questions I have on the slide here make references to DNR, LNR, which, as Dasha mentioned, are names of the are names that separatist groups in the Donbas region are in eastern Ukraine are calling their territory. So if we look at the questions on the top right hand side of the slide, it asks, in the event of an outbreak of hostilities, should Russia side with the separatists? And the findings from May of last year were split completely down the middle. So 43% of Russian respondents said definitely or probably yes, and 43% said no. But with the third question on the bottom of the slide, if the separatist republics asked to join Russia, should they be allowed to? The findings are much less ambiguous. 65% of respondents say definitely or probably yes, that this region, if asked to join Russia, should be allowed to. So we see a particular story of public opinion unfolding. First, blame for the West for the hostilities. And this fits really nicely into Vladimir Putin's narrative to domestic constituents that the West is hostile to Russia and its interests. A second piece is that we see that there's not a uniform opinion about whether Russia should take a side in the conflict, but a very clear sense that if these regions want to join Russia, they should be permitted. Next slide, please. So the next two slides I'm going to show have more recent data from Russia from December that look at Russian and Ukrainian public opinion of each other. And I apologize, these are in Russian. I took them directly from the Levada Center website and they have not yet been translated into English, but I've summarized the details on the sides of the slide. And the important takeaway I want you to take from this slide, which looks at Russian and Ukrainian attitudes towards each other is that in both Russia and Ukraine, residents have an overwhelmingly positive view of residents of the other countries. So 83% of Russians view residents of Ukraine positively, and 76% of Ukrainians view residents of Russia positively. Last slide. And so we see a real shift, though, when it comes to how residents of these countries look at the political leadership of the other countries. So in this slide, it looks at Russian attitudes towards Ukrainian political leadership and Ukrainian attitudes towards Russian political leadership. And we see it's a completely different story, where 67% of Russians view the political leadership of Ukraine negatively, and 76% of Ukrainians view the political leadership of Russia negatively. And to add to this, I'll just add a little bit more information from that I don't have a slide about, but coming from the Russian election studies, which is a series of studies that first began taking place in Russia in the mid-1990s. And the most recent survey took place in December. And while these results haven't been publicly released, some of the principal investigators shared relevant findings recently in the Washington Post. And a couple of these I just thought I'd report out to you. So only 8% of respondents in Russia think Russia should send military forces to fight against Ukrainian government troops in eastern Ukraine. Only 9% think Russia should train or equip separatist forces with Russian arms. And support for armed intervention has fallen among the Russian population by nearly half since 2016. And more importantly, it's dropped among a range of constituents. So that decline is widespread, including among members of Putin's United Russia Party. So the big takeaway that I'll say in the current moment is that while an assertive anti-Western foreign policy has generally helped Vladimir Putin domestically, and certainly helped Vladimir Putin in the annexation of Crimea in 2014, there appears to be little appetite among Russians for an armed conflict with Eastern Ukraine now. And I'll close off for now.
I wonder, while we are waiting for him to come on, if Dasha, you could share with us what you are hearing from your family.
Yeah, sure. So I've been pretty much trying to call them daily in the past month. So I would describe the situation of me reading the Western news, calling my family, and my mom calming me down and saying that everything is fine. That's how most of the conversations have been going in the past month. The population is pretty much calm. What I'm getting from like talking to my friends there outside of Donetsk and Lugansk regions is that, you know, for them, it is a little bit of more anxious because they, during the 2014, you know, and like the later years, they were a little bit further away from this conflict area. So even though that they know what's happening, they weren't, you know, like their places were not shelled ever, you know, like they didn't really hear shooting on like a daily basis as we did back in 2014. So they're a little bit more anxious. But as you saw in the video from Kiev, like most of the people are calm and prepared to resist in case of a full-blown invasion. As I said, there is no panic. Everything is functioning. Like, you know, the stores are full of food. I don't know what else. But
yeah, no, that's helpful.
That's pretty much it. Like, I think that everybody outside of Ukraine is more worried about us than we are about ourselves. Not because we downplay these risks, but because, you know, most of the people don't really have a chance to just stop their life at the moment and be, you know, fearful of the invasion that was supposed to, you know, happen today. Like people need to go to work, kids need to go to school, everything needs to keep functioning. Otherwise, you know, we would just pretty much surrender to, you know, this Russian escalation.
Right. Thank you. Thank you so much. And it looks like Bill is back. So we're ready for your presentation.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I apologize. My whole computer froze up and I had to reboot. So
we all understand.
I think I can build nicely, particularly on Danielle's presentation, by focusing on Russian foreign policy aims. And I will circle back at the end a little bit to some of the points she was making about the domestic politics side of this. But to begin with, the most important thing probably to note is that Russia's leaders and many Russians in the public feel strongly that their country must be a great power in world affairs. This is a high priority, and it's not one that began when Vladimir Putin became leader of Russia. It preceded that by at least a number of years during the Yeltsin period, sort of symbolized by a new foreign minister coming into office in the mid-1990s, who had a harder line view and was very popular in part for pushing the line that Russia was going to become a great power once more. So what does a great power mean from the Russian point of view? It means valuing a system like the Concert of Europe that operated in the 1800s, when the main powers at that time collaborated on preventing conflict among themselves, but also on resisting revolution and protest and putting down those kind of movements. So if you can imagine that kind of extended globally, that's part of what Russians' foreign policy elite have in mind when they say to themselves that they want Russia to be a great power. They want Russia to be involved in major decisions about security and other things globally. And of course, great powers also have spheres of influence. So that's another crucial part of what it means for Russia to be a great power. This map shows some of the areas that Russia views as countries that should be in its sphere of influence. The blue line there demarcates the former Soviet republics, or as Russia calls them, the near abroad, they are considered the ones that are of particular importance for Russian foreign policy. Also, of course, the countries that used to be in the Warsaw Pact with the Soviet Union, and the brown line, those to the right of the brown line, are indicated on the map. But also you hear often the argument that Russia has traditional interests in the Balkans, as indicated by the red line there, because of the time going back into the 1800s when Russia collaborated with opposition to the Ottoman Empire in that region. So those three different sets of countries kind of constitutes what Russians are looking for in terms of their of having a sphere of influence and having a decisive say in the politics of those countries, or sort of a priority claim to being influential with the foreign policy decisions of those countries. Now, there have been a number of American actions and or NATO actions that have happened in the post-Soviet era that have angered Russian leaders. The bombing of Serbia in 1999, withdrawing from the anti-ballistic missile treaty, which had been for a long time an important safeguard for strategic nuclear stability. The efforts to place missile defense installations in Central European NATO allies, the invasion of Iraq in 2003, the intervention in Libya in 2011, et cetera. So they have a kind of a long list of things that the United States and or NATO have done that from Russia's point of view are considered things that are very negative and are ones that they're very angry with the United States about. And of course, many people here, maybe in our audience, find those actions to be wrongheaded or immoral. But none of those things really help us understand Russia's recent massive buildup around Ukraine. They said they're being trotted out, but they really are a distraction because a military buildup of the kind we've seen in recent months doesn't really any kind of reaction to that in any sense. And of course, the biggest grievance that Russia has against the West and against the United States in particular is the expansion of NATO membership. So Jason, if you could show that next slide. This map shows the joining of post-communist countries into NATO. It came in three primary, in a couple of waves, but 1999, which you can see there in a kind of a light green, and 2004, those that are in more orange to the right. The countries that joined in those two waves were all, with one exception, countries that had been occupied and controlled by the Soviet Union in the 20th century. Now, at the time this was going on, I personally was very skeptical about NATO expansion. I thought that it was being rushed and ought to have been postponed. But the leaders of these Central European countries were aware of the strong support among the Russian elite for regaining Russia's superpower status. And they had an idea of what that would imply for their own relations with Russia in future years. So perhaps they were more foresightful about that than other observers were at the time. These NATO forces do not threaten Russia in any significant military sense. The US and the other NATO forces that are in these new members, they're there in small numbers. They're there to act as a tripwire to deter an attack from Russia. They are not, their forces are not configured in a way that would deal with any, or that would create opportunities for any kind of attack on Russia. Moreover, Russia remains a nuclear power, and that nuclear deterrence continues to provide them protection from any sort of conventional military attack. So the real issue for Russian officials, I think, with the expansion of NATO, and the reason it's being talked about so often by Russians, is that it seems to them a case of them being disrespected. Again, it's about not having the international respect and the respect, especially from the West, that they feel their status as a great power really deserves. So the NATO expansion has indeed angered them. I don't think there's any question that this is something that they feel is a wrong that has been done to them. But again, it doesn't really tell us why this is happening and what's what is driving Russia's interest in pressuring Ukraine and pressuring the West in the way it has. So having said that, though, I do want to stress that Ukraine is very important. Putin is probably right to see that that Ukraine constitutes a threat to Russian interests over the medium to long run in several ways. So for example, Ukraine is central to what Russia sees as its sphere of influence. If you look geographically, of course, it's central in that sense, but central in other ways as well, and to Russians' understanding of themselves and their history. To the extent that Russia has, especially since 2014, become less friendly toward Russia and less involved with Russian foreign policy initiatives, Russia's claim to have that sphere of influence is just correspondingly weaker. So with Russia going in, with Ukraine, going in a different direction in its foreign policy, it undermines Russia's reiteration of its claim to great power status. Russian-led organizations like the Commonwealth of Independent States and the Eurasian Economic Union that Putin has been trying to turn into an effective organization, they're really just not able to be as strong and effective without Ukraine as part of them, and Russia knows that. Secondly, there's the argument, and I think something Dasha said ties into this, that what Russia really fears from Ukraine is not that it might join NATO, but that it might join the European Union. right? And this was, it was a European Union decision that really sparked the events of late 2013, 2014. Ukraine remains a long way away from EU membership because they have to get their economy in order. They have to make big changes and reduce the amount of corruption that exists there and things like that. So EU membership is not necessarily any closer, but in some ways you can argue that it is more threatening because Russia's economy is having a very hard time modernizing and switching away from its dependence on exporting commodities to other countries for its budget and fighting its own corruption. So having a Ukraine that is able to reform and have dynamic economic growth join the European Union will shift shift its trade in a different direction and just kind of shift the mentality and create a more Western country right on Russia's border. And that seems to me to be something that would damage the ability of the leadership in Russia to continue to be popular and to continue to follow the economic path it has. And also, as many people have noted, Putin has been someone who reacts strongly to pro-democracy movements. He finds them to be threatening. Russia's use of the military has often, or its threats to use the military have often followed pro-democracy movements, the so-called color revolutions in Eastern and Central Europe. And he sees those as something that would provide a bad demonstration effect for the public. And something that he, has been trying to fight on a normative level internationally, and also simply to make sure that it doesn't happen in any way that his own people might get the wrong ideas from. In thinking about why now, let me mention some things that might help us understand why in 2021 we're seeing this, not in 2017 or not in 2025. What is it that might be going on in President Putin's mind that would make this seem like the time to strike when the iron is hot, so to speak? First, Western weakness, right? So you have increased polarization, the rise of right-wing populist parties, Brexit and the chaos it caused, President Trump denouncing NATO and the division within the alliance that seemed to generate, you know, things like that going on. So that's part of the background. Second, the important country of Belarus is now in the fold. It had been the Lukashenko, the authoritarian leader of Belarus, had been trying for some time, to the extent he could without going too far, to have some sort of balance between East and West, to some sort of independence from Russia in its foreign policy. In 2020, though, a popular uprising needed to be quashed, and he needed Russian help to do it. And that has seemingly put an end to any degree of separation between Russian foreign policy and Belarus. Lukashenko, not too long ago, made it quite clear that he supports Russia entirely in this, and that extends to using Belarusian troops to help with a conflict in Ukraine. A third factor that's important here is the friendship with China. Right? So Xi Jinping and Putin are said to be personally friendly. They speak warmly of each other. The last 8 years in particular, we've seen a lot of new trade deals and other kinds of agreements between the countries, including in military cooperation and in aligning their positions on world affairs, how they talk about international norms, how they define democracy, for example, which was a feature of a statement they made just a couple of weeks ago. A big share of the troops that have been positioned alongside or closer to the border with Ukraine came all the way from Siberia, came, in other words, from areas where they had formerly been positioned because of past conflicts with China. So the fact that there now are comparatively very few Russian troops positioned along Chinese borders suggests the degree of confidence that the Kremlin has about their good relations with China and is an interesting part of this. Another thing I'll mention briefly, Jason, you can show the next chart, is just that oil prices are high, and natural gas and other commodity prices tend to follow here. So this shows the spot price for a barrel of oil from the time that Putin came to power in August 1999. And you can see that the low period there on the right is the start of the pandemic, but that it's rebounded nicely. And so the Russian exports are making more money and the budget is benefiting from that. And anytime oil prices are high, it just creates a lot more flexibility for Russia and gives them greater capabilities. Okay, you can put that down now. And the final thing I'll mention is Russia's military reform. Russia has spent the last roughly 14 years since its short-term war with Georgia investing heavily in military equipment, personnel, and upgrading the readiness of their forces. And their air troops got the chance to gain a lot of experience in Syria in recent years. So Russia's just militarily stronger than it has been for quite some time. So nobody knows where this is all going to go, of course, right? I think even just right as we speak, some people are thinking that this may get resolved soon or calmed down, and other people are saying, no, you know, those troops aren't really moving anywhere, and we don't know what's going to happen. But my sense is that this is definitely something that's going to be a long-term issue. This is something that even if there's no full-scale invasion anytime in the near future, we're very likely to have this be a kind of military slash political confrontation between NATO and the United States on the one hand and Russia on the other for some time to come. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, all of you. I feel so much more informed. And I've actually been reading up on this as well as I can. So we have the Q&A open. I'm going to go ahead with the one that's been in there. And it actually speaks to one of your last slides, Bill. So with regard to kind of power commodities. So European countries would clearly be hurt if Russia cuts off natural gas exports in response to potential international sanctions, but how much would Russia be harmed by the loss of revenues from natural gas exports?
Well, I'll start, I guess, since I had the slide. You know, sanctions are to kind of paraphrase Winston Churchill, the worst of all foreign policy tools, except for all the others that involve fighting a military conflict, I guess, right? So it's very unclear how much, how effective sanctions are as a foreign policy tool. And this, you know, Russia has spent the last now, I guess, 8 years trying to reduce the impact that sanctions can have on its economy. You know, we live in an interconnected world, and anytime you cut off things through sanctions or tariffs or whatever it might be, it's a question of both sides being hurt. But which side will be hurt more is not is what it really will depend on. You know, I think that to the extent that the United States is serious about the sanctions, it has to, the United States and its allies, they have to put themselves in a position to accept the pain that will come from higher energy prices, among other things. They have to be willing to see financial markets in turmoil and other things. So, you know, I've just been seeing so much commentary from people about the sanctions and the costs on both sides that, you know, maybe the main thing to say is just this is unknown territory, and that's partly why this is scary to everybody.
Thank you. So given how little time we have, I'm going to jump to the question that seems less related to that, but I also want to say that panelists, you're welcome to go in and type answers to any of these if you feel like it. So comments about cyber attacks. So Dasha, you already referred to that a little bit. Ways that any of you see that playing into this?
So in the past year, we've been seeing like a growing number of cyber attacks, especially like over the past month. I believe it was end of January. So a lot of government websites were down and showing, like if you load it, it was showing like a scary tactic message, something about, you know, like Russian invasion and that you all Ukrainians are fascists and will come and save you kind of message. There was a recent attack yesterday. I was trying to load the Ministry of Defense website, which didn't work yesterday. I was like preparing the slides. I called my parents and asked them to load the page because I thought maybe my American VPN didn't work or something. They ran into the same problem. So they, my family went to the store yesterday. They couldn't pay with the credit card at the register, so they had to pay with cash. So there's been a little bit of, disruption of like the normal people's life. Basically, at least the official government response on that first attack that put down a lot of governmental websites was that no information was leaked, that they just kind of like blocked the servers. I know that Ukraine, also the government, is actively training people. We get help from like Western partners, including the United States, on the cyber attacks. So this is the ongoing issue, but the issue that Ukraine is addressing at the moment. So I think they are prepared for cyber attacks, and so we'll just keep doing our best and deterring that from happening. None of the major like issues that has created yet, I would say that.
And so I know that we are at time. I wonder if you can each leave us with a place that you would recommend that we go for information in the coming days and weeks. That might not be the first thing we think of.
I've been very angry with, I would say that personally, very angry with like a lot of Western media, growing like the pretty much just the growing panic around all of this. Misinterpreting a lot of Ukrainian government officials, keep sending the messages that were, debunked at some point. So unfortunately, like my personal, strategy was to, when I saw a lot of, comments about the press conference of President Zelensky in beginning of February, I got so frustrated, I just went and I watched the whole hour and a half of that conference in Ukrainian. Unfortunately, not a lot of people can, have the ability to do it and, watch it in the regional language. So I don't know that I have a solution, to be honest. I would just recommend to read, different sources and see different opinion, but also, just keep in mind that a lot of media, their goal is to sell the story. And sometimes they do overreact to a lot of these issues in order for, this headline to be more sellable. So I would just recommend to read from different sources and just keep in mind that some of it might be a little bit exaggerated.
Thank you.
I'm gonna make a suggestion that's a little bit more in a policy direction, which is to check out the program on new security approaches in Russia and Eurasia. The acronym is PONARS, P-O-N-A-R-S. You can just Google it. So it's a group of scholars from the region and internationally that regularly post policy memos, blogs, or write commentary for news outlets. And they have been providing various bits of analysis that are pretty intelligible and go a little bit deeper than what you're going to get in your news story. So that might be another great source to look for more information.
great. That's super helpful. Thank you.
There are Russian-based or Russian-adjacent news outlets that publish in English, and I check those out. I donate to them as well because they rely on subscriber donations. They're I think useful for finding out things about what's going on in Russia and by Russians. One's the Moscow Times. Or I think it's just the Moscow Times, all jammed together.com. There's the Medusa Project, which also does good investigative reporting, and they can both be found on the web in English.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. So we are a few minutes after, so we are going to close, and I'm sorry we didn't get to everyone's questions, but thanks to each of you for taking your time and for sharing your expertise and your personal experience with the region. It really means a lot and is very helpful. So thank you for sharing this evening with us, everybody out there, and we look forward to seeing you again at an Obermann Conversation.